Do you see presentation, PDF and pencil? Okay. So just briefly remind what we started to discuss on the previous lecture. So it was introduction of actually infinite family of various invariants in SL2R geometry. And there is the general rule how we can generate an infinite supply of such invariants. We just take any polynomial from the determinant normalized cycles, and then equate polynomial in with non-commutative variables to zero. Then that produce a certain relation between cycles, which will be invariant under Möbius transformation just to the property of cycles to be transformed under Möbius transformations by the matrix conjugation. And we produce one of the simple invariant, which was second order next after linear invariant, which was inner product related to orthogonality condition, which we consider it. And we find out what besides its expression in term of inner product, in term of such expression in corresponding Filmer-Schwinger-Knops matrices, it has interesting geometric interpretation as well. Somehow here came out and non-trivial, I will say it's a mysterious connection between the so-called foci for the cycles. So we introduce such foci which are just geometrically, classically connected to cycles if they are drawn as parabolas. So it's classical foci here. But the same foci making sense if we draw our cycles as circles or hyperbolas, and then a relation between foci of with circles appeared in this second type of orthogonality, focal orthogonality. So it's again, a kind of relation which rather difficult to guess or just to came by occasion in term of classical synthetic geometry, but it's appear rather naturally within our Erlangen approach based on symmetries. And also we will see what with focal orthogonality, although it may look a bit exotic, nevertheless appear again and again, just like with strange foci for circles, which we already discussed, here appear surprisingly. So similarly with focal orthogonality appears once more when we discuss distances and lengths later. Maybe, so there are, of course, as usual, various flavors related to three different types of point matrix and three different types of cycle matrix with focal orthogonality, but we can treat them in uniform way using our language of corresponding complex dual and double numbers. Let's consider maybe less exotic, but another second order invariant relation between cycles, which related to a well-known geometrical property to be tangent. But first, let us start from standard, more or less standard discussion of inner product and corresponding Cauchy-Schwarz inequality in the when inner product is defined. Of course, you probably met on many occasions in linear algebra, in Hilbert spaces, Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, which says what the square of inner product of two vectors x, y is bounded by the product of the normal vector x, normal vector y, absolute value here, or we just can expand it saying what xy times xy is less or equal, if you recall, what is norm in the inner product space is square, its square is inner product of vector with itself. So we get that form of Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. So if you look back to the proof of Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, it essentially uses the property what inner product is always a vector with itself is always non-negative. So the starting point of any demonstration for this inequality in inner product space is that property which does not hold anymore if our, so that property does not hold anymore if we are in the indefinite inner product space. For example, in our space of cycles, we already discussed what inner product defined in the cycle space. Here is the formula for this inner product from one of the previous lectures. So it's not positively defined, so it may take any values. And correspondingly, the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality can take any direction. So we always can find vectors x and y in the inner product, in the indefinite product space, such that either greater, equal, or less is satisfied by that relation. But there is a certain interesting property. What type of the relation is preserved by the linear spans? So if we have two vectors x and y which are satisfied either one form of this inequality with the less sign or the same form of or different form of this inequality with the greater sign, then any vectors z and double o which are the real linear combination of x and y satisfy just exactly the same inequalities. And if we have identity, so identity of this type for initial vector x, y, we have again identity for the inner product. So that is just a general result from linear algebra. So for linear algebra, so it's true in any indefinite inner product space. But in our situation, linear spans of cycles have again explicit geometrical interpretation as corresponding pencils. So here we have solid green, solid blue cycles, and that is our intermediate cycles which are linear span of them. So they form such classical pencils. So we are looking for geometric meaning, what this inequality means for such vectors. And relation is as follows. So if we have here inequality on one or another type, then it's respectively means what our cycles either are intersecting, equality means tangent, and inequality means disjoint, as opposite inequality means these cycles are disjoint. So here to distinguish this cycle, this pencil from this pencil, we may just say what here we have inequality with cycles with the sign less, so greater, and this one is for the sign less. And equality correspond to the pencils with two tangent generating cycles. So we again see such pencils. If that middle pencils here in the middle column generated by two tangent cycles, and all cycles in with pencils are again tangent. So actually, so if we will come back to the previous statement, what it does tell us, so previous statement, actually this is how that previous statement was realized. So if we have two initial vectors with certain relation, then any vector in the linear span has the corresponding relation, the corresponding type of inequality between them. This is just was discovered looking on the pictures of the pencils and corresponding interpretation. So if we have two initial cycles which are disjoint, then any cycle in this pencil are disjoint. And if we are intersecting, two cycles which span the pencil intersecting, well, then all of them are intersecting. And equality means tangency. So just using the condition, what equality here means tangency, so this is that middle column for cycles, we can slightly rearrange it and say what if two cycles are with normalized determinant, then they are tangent if and only if cycle which is a sum of these two cycles is self-orthogonal, so isotropic, self-orthogonal, or the zero radius. So again, that type of cycles was discussed on several occasions, zero radius cycles in elliptic case represent point, or in hyperbolic case represent null con passing to the through the corresponding point. So we have just statement what a sum of two cycles in normalized form shall be a zero cycle. What is the zero cycle? Interesting property is what with a zero cycle just centered and the tangent point of these two cycles C and C tilde. So again, coming back to these images of tangent pencils. So you take any two pencils here, two cycle from this blue pencil, and if you add them in the determinant normalized form, you obtain just that cycle which corresponds to the tangency point. So that is the condition which we obtain as the second order invariant. So again, a relation, as you look on that inequalities which we have, for example, tangency, which is given by identity in that formula. So this is a second order invariant. So with respect to coefficient of any cycle C or C tilde, it's a second order one. So that is another example of nonlinear invariant of Möbius transformation. So if we have two cycles which are tangent and make a Möbius transformation of this pair, image of this pair will be again pair of tangent cycles. So that is property which is invariant under Möbius transformation. again, just another interesting property. We may rather trivially rewrite the condition that determinant of a cycle in parabolic version of Filmer-Springer-Knopf construction is equal to zero. In this case, we can add to the cycle anything which has only non-zero coefficient with the third parameter, and that is actually the cycle which represents the real line. So I just recall what this is coefficients k, l, n, m, which we are arranged in this way. And if we have this coefficient here, that corresponds to the equation n v is equal to zero. So that is the real line. So that is points on the real line which we obtain in this way. So, and we can add that one here just because for parabolic determinant, that third condition is not important. And then that means, again, in view of previous identity, that means what this cycle is tangent to cycle R. And if where C and R are by that Cartesian Kirillov condition, we have a tangency. And actually, it's just once more verified the relation which we already noticed before. So when we have a parabolic zero radius cycle realized is a circle or parabola or hyperbola, its parabolic zero radius means what it's tangent to the real line. So this is just another demonstration of that property which we have seen before. So just it come proved now. Furthermore, we may not only work with the intersections in, say, special position with like orthogonality or tangency, so 90 degrees or 0 degrees, we actually can measure angle of intersection for we may measure angle of intersection for any two cycles. Actually, in determinant normalized form, inner product of with two cycles gives cosine of the intersection angle. So this is general meaning of the inner product. And here again come an interesting theorem, which also can be demonstrated both in elliptic and hyperbolic case. So assume I have two cycles, A and B, shown on this picture in red. So A and B shown in red. And I put a condition what I am looking for a cycle which has some given intersection angle with cycle A and some other intersection angle with cycle B. So I look for all such cycles. Once we draw all that cycles with given intersection angle, we will notice what way turned to be a tangent to a pair of other cycle. Again, we may call it ghost cycles A prime and B prime. So the condition what our family of blue and green cycles make intersection angle with A and B of given value is equivalent what way are tangent to the with ghost cycles A prime B prime. Again, that can be a statement if you will think about synthetic proof of this theorem. At least for me, it's look rather challenging. But if we try to prove it using the geometry of cycles and geometry of indefinite product space of cycle, then proof is just rather straightforward, a kind of analytical computation, simple analytical computation, and it relatively simple in the sense what it's straightforward, and it can be done using computer algebra even. And so, besides of proving that statement, it also give an explicit expression for cycles A prime and B prime. They are both turned to be linear combination of cycles A and B, so they belong to the same pencil. So this is A prime and B prime, just as the same belong to the same pencil. And that theorem also true for the hyperbolic case as well. So here we have two hyperbolas, A and B. So this is two branches of hyperbola A, say. This is two branches of hyperbola B. Again, we ask for certain intersection angle with both of them. So each hyperbola has its own intersection angle, one angle with A and another angle with B. And then it's turned out what there is that black ghost, two black ghost hyperbolas here, such what all green and blue are tangent to them. Actually, what interesting between these two pictures, the one and another, they are showing exactly the same, so these two pictures showing exactly the same cycles, just parameter of metric is changed. All other parameters of cycles for A, B, and tangent one remain the same. So it's only the metric of the point space is changed from elliptic to hyperbolic. So this is in term of cycle space, this is exactly the same collection of vectors. So it's just different image on the point space. So that is examples of second order invariants which we have, and what we considered so far was one way or another way connected with the angles of intersections, so angle between two cycles in terms of the intersection points. Let us look on metrical invariant. So how we can measure distances, not only angles, but also distances using cycles. So let's again to get we get some inspiration from the classical geometry and look on the possibility to measure distances in classical geometry, and standard procedure kind of one we have in usual geometry. When you have two points and some given ruler, you may just use your ruler to take what is the distance between point and then apply it to the ruler. So this is a kind of measurement which we do at secondary schools in elementary geometry, and we are looking for a procedure which will more or less replicate it in our more general case. And here, so compass is the device which make just circles for us. So ideal circles can be drawn in this way. With given center, and then we may measure a distance in a couple of different way actually here. So one of the possibility, but for any way to measure a distance, we need to know size of cycles themselves. And that can be again started from the Filner-Springer-Knops construction, as we identified our cycles with certain matrices. So in this identification, we said what if our matrix is such what parameter k is equal to 1, then determinant of this matrix produce exactly square of the radius for the circle described by this cycle. Determinant of this matrix in case of circles produce square of the radius. What determinant produce for parabolas? For parabolas, answer also is geometrically explicit. So if we will look on this formula and just put here the parabolic coordinates, then the determinant produce the distance between a real root of the parabola, if this parabola has one or two roots, and if it's like green parabola here, which does not have real roots, we take its reflection in vertical axis with the same vertex of parabola, and then two root appears, and we again measure the square of the distance between them. Just again, square of the distance is equal to zero in the case if parabola is touching the real axis. So this is again what we said even today, what this type of distances just became zero radius. So it's intersection points, distance between intersection points. So one way or another, for circles or parabolas, determinant of Filner-Springer-Knopf's matrix give the size of our cycle. So if we know the size of a cycle, how we can measure the distance between points? One of possibility is just to look on all possible cycles passing two given points. So as we know, it will be a pencil. And among all cycles in this pencil, we are just picking up one with the smallest size. So of course, that will be just the circle with the diameter given with endpoints at these two points. So this is how we can measure a distance between points using our cycle. So here it's extremal value which we are taking. Now, what would be the parabolic distance measured in this way? So assume again we have two points on the plane, and we are drawing all possible parabolas passing these two points. And each time measure the distance, and we will see what actually what we will have. The extremal value for distances appears when a parabola degenerates into two vertical lines passing through our point. So if we have a degenerate type of picture, then it will be extremal value for the distances of real roots which we obtain. And that extremal value obviously distance between points Z1 and Z prime will be just U minus U prime, where we have coordinates U and V here. And that is in good relation to all that uniform treatment of the distance or all parameters which we had so far, all geometrical notions. So essentially, distance which appears in this way is given by the formula like that. So if we in elliptic case and sigma is equal to minus one, we have here just Pythagoras rule, so usual distance. In case of hyperbolic situation, we have sigma equal to 1. We have Minkowski type distance between points, and it can be square with distances positive or negative. So in hyperbolic case, two cases where distance is positive or negative, or other way around, correspond to situation where our interval between two points is either space-like or time-like. So again, with quite explicit geometrical physical meaning, that distance which appears. In parabolic case, sigma is equal to zero, so we just left with that kind of degenerate distance, which is independent from coordinate V. So it's just a distance in first coordinate U, or first coordinate of the coordinate. This is correspond to the geometry of Galilean space-time, with U being space coordinate, V being space coordinate, and U being time coordinate. So the distance which we obtain here means we have absolute time. So idea is what in classical mechanics, there is no transformation which affect distance between between events in time coordinate. So time is absolute. You can do transformation which affect the distance between two space-time event in the space, just by Galilean boost, for example. But for the time, we do not have a transformation which affect it, so that distance, that type of degenerate distance which we had before, is just correspond to that physical interpretation of dual numbers. Again, physically it's all right, it's quite sensible, but geometrically we want to have a kind of non-trivial distance in parabolic situation, which will take in account the second component V as well. And here came a second possibility how we can measure the distance between two points on the plane, again using the compass. So we take two points, so Z and Z prime, and we just then put one leg of the compass at point Z and try to find the circle which is passing the second point. And when one half of the diameter, which is the radius for such a circle, will be the measured possibility, so will be the length of this interval between Z and Z prime. So in Euclidean geometry, on the usual Euclidean plane, both procedures, the previous procedure with the diameters, which we discussed before, and this procedure, so previous procedure with the diameter, and that procedure give exactly the same answer, but in general geometry of dual and double numbers, these answers became different. So what happened for parabolic situation, which we are interested most, because it's a kind of degeneracy which we are trying to resolve. So when we are, first of all, what will be observation from that procedure when we are measuring distance in this way? Unlike the previous, where we have Z and Z prime to be diameter of the same circle, so the role of Z and Z prime here was symmetric. They both belong to this circle. Here, the role of Z and Z prime are different. Z is in the center and Z prime is on the circle. So it's not symmetric. And second, possibility is what for our cycles, we have not only centers, we have also foci. And then for a possibility to put Z here can be either center of the cycle or its focus. And then we are just placing the corresponding cycle which passes the other point Z prime. So coming back to parabolic situation, how concentric parabolas are look like? How concentric circles are look like, you of course know. So here is an example of two concentric circles. They have the same center. But for concentric parabolas, picture is as follow. These parabolas are obtained by vertical shift one from another. So on the left picture on presentation PDF file, we have concentric parabolas. These parabolas with the same center, fixed center, C elliptic shown on this picture. And how confocal parabolas look like? Again, here we just take the parabolic focus. We look for the parabolas which have joint vertex. This is vertex correspond to parabolic focus here. So this is what we obtain. And when we are looking on this family, we see what indeed they satisfy to all conditions which we need for measuring length. First of all, they either concentric or confocal, they fill up the plane. So there is just one cycle, one particular parabola, which has given center CE and pass given point on the place, plane, pass some other point. There is just one particular parabola. And similarly for focal, confocal parabolas. So again, there is just one particular parabola with given vertex passing given point. So that parabola is uniquely defined. And once this parabola is uniquely defined, we are measuring its size, looking on its intersection with the real line, say, or by other procedure. So in this way, we have a definition of different lengths which appears. Actually, changing parameters which came to this procedure, we get 54 different lengths. How it appears? First of all, we have three different geometry in the point space. So if there are two points on the plane, we may treat it either as elliptic or parabolic or hyperbolic. Then, correspondingly, we use either hyperbolas, parabolas, or circles to measure distance. Once we establish which hyperbola, parabola, or circle satisfy our condition, we may evaluate its distance in three different way using three different cycle metric. After that, diameter of this corresponding cycle again can be evaluated in three different ways using three different geometries. And finally, we have two parameters. Either we use confocal or concentric cycles. So that is two other parameters. So it looks like a huge amount of different lengths. And really, it looks like we even cannot expect what all of them will be meaningful. But nevertheless, they are. And meaning of this lens is showing as follows. So let me recall a conformality property. Typically, this is studied in complex analysis. So conformal from complex plane to complex plane. They are defined in the informal fashion, saying that preserve infinitesimal shapes. So what typically does it mean? If I have two curves and on C and make a conformal map to some other curves, when that angle between corresponding tangents shall be the same. So this is angle preservation property for conformal map. And other property is that conformal map preserve send infinitesimal circles into infinitesimal circles. That means if I have a point and draw a small circle around and look on its corresponding image, it may be probably not a circle, but if radius tends to zero, here that shape again tends to a round circle of infinitesimally small radius. So that is informal explanation. The formal relation is as follows. So we have a distance between a point and a small displacement with parameter t, and we compare the ratio to the initial distance between given point and its small displacement. And that ratio shall be independent from the direction in which we make a displacement. So that shall be independent from the direction of displacement y prime. That is a formal definition of conformality. And it turned out what the three distances or nine distances which we defined before, they are conformal if and only if the geometry of point space and cycle space are the same. So here shall be correspondence between them. So for distances, there is a rather strict condition for conformality. But lengths, which we defined before, 54 lengths with from center or from foci, they are all conformal in this sense. So regardless which point space, cycle space geometry is used in all cases, we get the conformality of this expression for that. So length produce an invariance, infinitesimal invariance of our geometry, SL2 geometry. Probably it's time to stop this lecture now. Questions? Okay, thank you very much. Please don't forget to mark